Welcome to the Riff Crew. I'm your host, Steve Mitchell, back for another big episode. Unfortunately, Skull can't make us today, but one man who can make us all the way from Columbia is Geoff Tate. That's welcome to the program.
I ended up as a patient in his...
Hey, how are you?
I'm doing great. Now, how about yourself? Because you've certainly hit the road pretty hard since things have opened back up. How's the South American leg going for you so far?
Oh, it's been great so far. I think we have two shows left, one tonight in Bogota, Colombia, and then one in San Jose, Costa Rica, coming up. And then it's home for a day, and then off to Australia. Can't wait.
Yeah. And how would you describe the South American audiences compared to other parts of the world?
Oh, gosh, it depends on where you are. In places like Rio, for example, in Brazil, they're kind of manic in a sense that they kind of give themselves into the show, and they move around a lot. They're very movement-oriented culture, I think. Places like Santiago, Chile, for example, they're more of a listening audience, you know, not so movable, I guess. So, yeah, it really depends on what country you're traveling in, you know, what sort of culture you engage in. And you never know, you know, when you present your music, how people are going to take it, and songs that some places really relate to and let you know they're relating to it. Others, not so much, you know. It's different. It's different and interesting everywhere you go.
And have you noticed much of a difference between the reception between the Operation Mindcrime tour that you did a few years ago, and because you, I think you were on the road for about 3 years with that particular tour, and how the shows have been so far on this one?
Oh, they've been great. Yeah, no difference. I mean, it's pandemonium, actually.
Cool. And I know it's a bit of a cliche, but with the bands getting hit so hard during all the lockdowns, but you were is probably hardest hit as anyone because all of your band was in Europe, and I take it you needed to basically rebuild the band from scratch again. So, what was that process like for you?
Oh gosh, let me think back that far. I think we actually only had like about 6 months where we weren't actually touring still, because you know, different countries were open at different times and closed at different times, and so we just sort of took advantage of where places were open and the rule we could work within their rules. You know, I remember there was a show in Florida that we did in the south of Florida, and they were like the only venue open in the whole state because they had installed this incredible ventilation system and they had social distancing amongst all the people, and the place just sold out as many as they could sell, and people were so happy to have the show. But you know, we all had to follow the rules, and you know, luckily that's all kind of relaxed quite a bit now. Except on a plane flight I took the other day, I had to wear a mask, but that was like one in 10 plane flights. So I'm feeling pretty good that things are slowly getting back to normal, you know.
Yeah, and I understand you had heart surgery last year. So how's that been for you? Just, you know, constantly being on the road. Like, do you feel back to full health now?
I feel great. I feel like it took brought me back 30 years. You know, I feel strong and energetic. And it's funny, I didn't really realize I was feeling that badly until I had the surgery done. And then now I feel like incredible. I guess you kind of get used to how you feel, right? And you sort of acclimate to it, you know, in a sense. Like today, I'm out walking around Bogota. It's over 8,000 feet in the air, you know, and I got no problem. You know, yesterday I was in Chile in the Andes Mountains, and we were hiking around through the mountains, and it was over 10,000 feet, and I was having no issues at all. And typically, when I was be in that situation, I'd be huffing and puffing and blowing hard and having to stop, you know, that kind of thing. And now I feel great. Feel back to the way I feel I should have been feeling.
And with that in mind, did you try and schedule your tours so you've got more rest days, and so not just you know, to pace yourself, but also
No.
do no, it's still 100% hardcore.
No. Oh yeah, I'm just going for it, you know. We're trying to make up a lot of the shows that we had sold previous to the pandemic, and you know, people had to wait. A lot of shows got postponed and canceled and moved to a different date, and I just feel really bad about disappointing ticket holders. You know, I want to fulfill the promise and make it to the city and play the show. And so we've been kind of catching up, and I don't want to leave anybody out, you know.
Yeah, because I remember last time you were out here in 2020, you'd already announced the Empire Tour, and you may have actually started one or two shows, or a handful of shows, if I recall correctly.
Right.
But this time around, you've also clubbed in Rage for Order, so it's a double album show. So was that originally planned, or is that something you sort of cooked up?
Yeah. Well, we had originally started the 30-year anniversary of the Empire album, and to kind of satisfy my own whims, I wanted to play all of Rage for Order as well, because it's one of my favorite albums. And so we started that tour after we left Australia, actually, in 2020. And then the whole world changed, and so we had to shut everything down. So we only had maybe a month of shows playing Rage for Order and Empire before we had to shut it down. So since or post-pandemic, we've been playing this presentation.
Hey, Jack, give us some bass. Oh, yeah. This one's for you. Come on, baby. Bring me some of your blue sky.
mentioned Rage for Order is one of your favorite albums. Was that the reason why that album was selected over other ones?
I just like every song, and I never got a chance to play it all. You know, typically when you would release an album, you would only play maybe two songs from the album, and you'd add that to your existing set, you know, that you did. And and then that album cycle would, you know, finish, and you would begin another album, and you'd add two new songs from that album onto the set list. And so you'd never go back and revisit other songs on the previous albums, you know. So I really wanted to play it live, and I'm definitely getting to live out my my dream, you know, my bucket list dream.
Well, speaking of a bucket list, in terms of your musical career, I think you're up to 19 albums or something like that. What's your sort of goals or motivations outside of touring from a musical perspective?
I mean, what else would I like to do musically?
Yeah, you know, are there artists you'd like to work with, or particular projects you have in mind? You know, for example, you know, the next album, would it be a solo album? Would it be a collaboration? Have you got any sort of desires in terms of what you'd like to create?
Yeah, I have. A couple years ago, I started doing an album with a group of Italian artists called Sweet Oblivion. And we've done two albums, and we're about to begin work on our third album that should be out sometime this year, I guess. And I also have a solo album that's almost finished that should be out later this year as well. And I have another project that I'm kind of tinkering around with as well. So yeah, I have three different things on the horizon that I'm playing with right now.
Okay. And sort of over the last decade, when you've been essentially touring as a solo artist, have there been any bands reach out to you and say, hey, would you like to join us?
No, not really. No, I mean, I've done guest appearances with Avantasia, for example. I've done three records with them now. But besides that, no. And I'm not really interested in joining anybody, you know, maybe as a collaboration or something like that, but not a permanent band member, no.
Yeah. And of course, the early days of Queensryche, you guys were up Washington State, the Seattle area. Did you guys ever run into or play shows with Metal Church?
Metal Church? Oh, yeah. 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 All the way up into the... I've done several shows with them over the years, festivals. I'm trying to think of the last one we did was maybe at the most 4 or 5 years ago, I would think.
Okay. And how much of the Seattle scene sort of influenced that early sound? Like, were you or the other guys in the band into, you know, the likes of Heart or Jimi Hendrix and so forth?
Well, Seattle had a very rich history of artists and music, going back to the 1940s with Bing Crosby, very famous American crooner, I guess you'd call him. We had the Kingsmen, and Paul Revere and the Raiders were huge. Steve Miller Band is from Seattle area. Hard, of course, and then we came out. And then from there on, we've had, of course, Pearl Jam and Nirvana and Alice in Chains and what's that guy's name that had that song about stealing clothes from a secondhand store? Macklemore, yeah, at him. He was a very popular artist from Seattle now. Yeah, quite a history, really. But, you know, I guess to clarify your question there a little bit, I think we were mostly as a band, we were influenced by our generation, you know, growing up with the 60s and the 70s music of the time, which was very rich, you know, and it's in what it was. It was a very experimental time in musical history, and it was pre-genre, you know, before people started carving music up and putting it in little boxes in order to sell it. It was before that, so there was a lot of freedom to create what you wanted, without fear of not being in the club, so to speak, you know, with, oh, you're not metal, or you're not death metal, or you're not, I don't know, this week's version of metal, you know. It's become quite ridiculous, really.
Thank you.
was the Seattle scene very supportive of the type of music that you were playing in the early days? Was it easy to, you know, get clubs, you know, to open the doors for you?
No, we our first show we did was in a theater supporting another band called Zebra, which was kind of a hit band at the time, having a doing a Northwest tour. And I think our third show was opening for Quiet Riot on their Metal Health album. We didn't play clubs. We started out as an opening act and, you know, releasing our own material. And at the time, in where we lived, in the Seattle area, clubs didn't, they didn't support local original music. It was kind of dominated by what we called top 40 bands, bands that would play cover material. And people go out dancing and, you know, that kind of thing. And it definitely wasn't our scene that we did. And there were no clubs where we could play. We would play like events, you know, like a bunch of guys would get together and buy kegs of beer and they would put on a party and they would call it, you know, Metal Fest, you know, something like that. And we would play that, you know. But once we became Queensryche, no, we never played clubs.
And so what were the, apart from obviously the music itself, but what were the key milestones or key points that sort of took you from those, you know, keg parties to, you know, basically getting on the road and touring and making a name for yourself?
Well, we put out our own album, you know, the Queensryche EP, and that started us on a pathway, I guess you'd say. Got us picked up by EMI Records. We signed a deal with them and we started selling records and, you know, making a name for ourselves touring.
And obviously the music industry is no longer the music industry of the 80s. How do you find, you know, working in the modern environment where, you know, it's basically streaming and not much else?
How do I find it? Well, I guess I've been around long enough to learn how to adapt to changing situations, different scenarios. And you just kind of, you don't pine away for the good old days because those are way behind you. You know, you kind of move on and accept what works for people now and you do it, you know.
And so apart from the touring, have you found any sort of approaches that work for you in terms of getting that traction or connection with fans?
I don't know what you mean.
Oh, so, you know, obviously in the 80s, you know, MTV was the big thing and, you know, the big, you know, $200,000-$300,000 budgets for music videos, and that was sort of the way to get the connection with the fans. Obviously those days are behind us, so are there different ways that you find that you can connect with fans?
Live, yeah. Playing shows, traveling around the world is the best way. At least for me, it works really well.
And what are your memories like of the last Australian tour?
Oh, let's see. Lots of birds, visits to wineries, great conversations with people, enthusiastic audiences, sightseeing. We were there in the winter, I believe it was. So it was kind of a different experience because I've only been there in the summer season. So it was quite different in the winter, you know, which I like. I like traveling and I like going to places. So it doesn't matter what time of year. It's cool to see how it is, you know.
And just touching back on your bucket list, musical list, if you like, a number of hard rock singers have made the move from sort of a live circuit to musical theater. Is that something that you've ever had a desire to, or inkling to move towards?
It doesn't pay enough, actually.
Yeah. But
so no.
But as a bucket list, is that something that you'd like, you know, just to do one time, just for the experience?
I suppose if it was my own music, I'd have a different thought about it. Yeah. But performing other people's stuff, I don't really have a huge motivation to do that. No, I'm not a fan of Broadway and that kind of musical anyway. You know, doesn't appeal to me.
Cool. And obviously with your experience over the many decades in the music scene, what would be your biggest lessons to upcoming musicians that you'd like to share?
Advice for upcoming musicians?
Yeah, from your experience.
Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
Oh gosh. I don't usually hand out advice unless I'm asked specifically. I'd say follow your heart, you know, be honest with your desires with music and follow that, follow your muse, you know, see where it takes you.
Cool. And any last messages to the fans coming up to see you in Australia next week?
Oh, I'd say thanks for your interest, and it's going to be a fun series of shows, and I can't wait to see everybody there.
How about one more? Believe it, 20 years into the 21st century. So many changes, so many changes. Things are moving pretty fast, right? Oh my God. Every day, something new, something new, something new. It's hard to keep up. But you know what? I can't turn it off. I can't shut it down.